the Chemistry and Its Element podcast. Curious tales of chemical compounds.
This week, Georgia Mills discovers the unpleasant surprise in store for insistent insect collectors.
What unites photography, skin cream, vanilla flavour, and exploding beetle bums? Very specific, but I'm glad you asked. Hydroquinone, like so many things, is composed of hydrogen, oxygen, and carbon. It's a simple structure, a benzene ring with two flailing hydroxyl arms opposite each other. As you may expect from a ping pong ball with arms, hydroquinone is pretty reactive. It's also slightly acidic and, on a non-molecular scale, forms a white granular solid. Humans can manufacture it, and we'll get to how later, but it pops up fairly frequently in the animal kingdom, usually in association with an animal's rear end. Bombardier beetles have arguably the world's greatest superpower. When they're threatened, they raise their bums in the air and explosively release a hot, noxious chemical spray. Their deterrent is a mixture of hydroquinone and hydrogen peroxide, well known for its use in hair dye. Inside the beetle, the two compounds are stored safely, but when it's time for the posterior party, they're pushed into a chamber where they're joined by catalytic enzymes. The hydrogen peroxide decomposes and the hydroquinone oxidizes, forming, among other things, benzoquinone, which is an irritant to most vertebrate eyes and lungs. Unfortunately for any bumbling beetle botherers, the energy released can cause the spray to reach nearly 100 degrees. And what's more, as you'd expect from an exploding bum, it smells pretty bad. Now, while we're on the subject of animal behinds, hydroquinone is also one of the components of castoreum, another foul-smelling substance which is found in beaver anal cavities, or castor sacs. Rather than detonating their derrieres, the beavers use this concoction, alongside urine, to mark their territory. And upon discovering this, humans did the obvious thing and started putting it in their perfume. Apparently, once left for a few years, it takes on a charming leathery smell. Castoreum has also been approved by the FDA for use in food flavourings, including vanilla. But it's very unlikely that you've ever had this, as unsurprisingly, there are much easier ways of getting vanillin than by milking a beaver's backside. If you're disappointed by that, don't worry, you can take a trip to Sweden and try some of their schnapps called beaverhoit. Excuse the pronunciation, that literally means beaver shout and is made using castoreum. Hydroquinone also pops up elsewhere in nature. It's found in certain types of mushrooms and also in propolis, the glue that bees make to fix their hives. And we humans make quite a bit of it industrially. There are two main ways, the cumin process, which reacts benzene and propene together with some added air and acid, or by reacting phenol with hydrogen peroxide. There are a few reasons why we bother. It's a reducing agent, which is soluble in water, which makes it of interest to photographers. Hydroquinone reduces silver halides to make fine particles of silver. These look black and so develop a photograph. But one of the most popular and also controversial uses of hydroquinone is in skin depigmentation. It can reduce the production of melanin, the compound which creates skin tone. It does this by inhibiting an important enzyme called tyrosinase, which causes cells to produce fewer and more abnormal melanosomes, which are the tiny structures inside cells which create and transport melanin. But is this safe? It has been linked to some very unpleasant side effects, especially at high concentrations, things like dermatitis or skin irritation, sensitivity to the sun, or permanent patchy discoloured skin. Plus, animal studies have left some concerns over potential links to cancer. Over-the-counter skin whitening creams containing hydroquinone are banned in Europe. However, the UK is seeing an increase in illegal imports. The local government authority declared it the biological equivalent of paint stripper after a swell in seizures of products containing hydroquinone, often at very unsafe levels. However, you can get prescribed hydroquinone to treat things like hyperpigmentation. And one study has argued that in over 50 years of medical use, there have been no documented cases of resulting cancers. And another study suggests that people who work in manufacture and the use of hydroquinone are actually less likely to suffer from cancer than the general population, although why this is a big question mark. One of the big problems with determining how dangerous hydroquinone might be is that it's often found in bootleg products, either at high quantities or alongside contaminants like mercury. So it's very hard to untangle the effects of unsafe use and other toxic compounds. And however you feel about the act of skin depigmentation, it's a billion-dollar industry and it's expected to double in the next 10 years. So this means safe products which have been tested in short and long term are definitely needed. And there needs to be good information about what a harmless-looking pot of skin cream at your local market could actually do.
That was Georgia Mills with Hydroquinone. Next time, Brian Clegg will have you salivating.
Spit a drop of saliva onto your finger and you're looking at a solution containing amylase. Some mammals, humans included, have amylase in their saliva to help break down foodstuffs. It's the job of that amylase to get started on the carbohydrates in starchy foods, splitting them into component sugars.
Join Brian in the next Chemistry and Its Element podcast and find all of our previous pods at chemistryworld.com/podcasts. And if you don't see your favourite compound in the list, let us know and we'll see what we can do. Email chemistryworld@rsc.org or tweet @chemistryworld. I'm Ben Valsler. Thank you for joining me.